Schools are not just buildings where students come to learn. They can be important places for connection and belonging. But what exactly is the role of schools within the larger community, and how do all stakeholders contribute to creating a nurturing environment for our students? Well, joining me today to unpack some of our latest insights into these topics from our Building Thriving School Communities report is McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Sophie, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Always a delight.
I mentioned the new report that we've just released, which kind of fits under our banner of our annual education future research. Every year we kind of delve into a new nuanced topic about the trends and the research and the insights that are impacting the future of education. And you've kind of been at the helm of some of these studies over the last couple of years. So there's no one better placed to come on the podcast today and tell us about this. But before we get into these latest insights, Soph, we are chatting about our latest iteration of this study. Could you please explain to our listeners what the study this year focused on and a bit about how we gathered these insights?
Sure can. This year's report was all about building thriving school communities. Over our more than a decade in education and research and stakeholder studies with schools and PD days, like we hear a lot from the education sector and teachers. We love the education sector, but we've heard a lot around, I guess, some of the challenges around how society is changing, expectations are changing, and how do you really understand what makes a school a really effective, thriving community, and particularly when we look at the sense of loneliness and challenges that young people are facing across their lives. It's like, how can we help schools really thrive to meet the needs of today's students? So we drew on all of our years of experience to really craft that survey to help us understand that. And then we surveyed parents, 557 parents across the nation to be exact, 521 teachers, and 350 year 9 to 12 students across government, independent, and Catholic sector to be able to really understand a school and measure the health of a school and understand the experiences of those key stakeholders.
Yeah, it's a really fascinating report and a really interesting sample as well, like you mentioned, across those three different stakeholder groups. So if I'd love to hear what you believe the role of schools is today in fostering connection and a sense of belonging within their communities, I guess prefacing that we know that our communities are changing, how and where we go to for communities kind of evolved over time. What kind of role do you see schools playing in that kind of in modern day society?
Schools play a crucial role in that area, and we see it as kind of one of those last mediating institutions between that's a structure that allows or provides an avenue for social change, and is also a gathering place, as we see so many of our gathering places in society deconstructed or evolving. Schools is one where you have a space where all the generations connect, where you've got your teachers, your parents, your grandparents' day, your young people. So it's kind of that, I guess, melting pot in some ways. So the opportunity that schools have to help facilitate that sense of connection and belonging within their communities is significant. And as I mentioned before, we see that loneliness epidemic across Australia, with 59% of Australians overall often or sometimes feeling lonely. And that is highest for our youngest generation and Gen Z, followed by Gen Y, then Gen X, and then our baby boomers. So the sense of connection that a school can foster is incredibly powerful for the young people that attend, but also for the teachers and the parents and those in the wider school community. Like, we remember growing up and going to the school fairs or the school, you know, fetes or the shows. They create gathering moments for people in community to come connect and celebrate together. So they really do play a crucial role in facilitating and enhancing a sense of cohesion and community in their local area. And we know that when people feel safe and feel like they belong, it creates that opportunity for learning at a deeper level as well. So yeah, massive part. We're a massive advocate for the education sector in our local schools.
Yeah, I think it's interesting for me to have observed that over time as well. Like, you know, from being a student back in the day, of course, you know, students, it's schools where they go to meet their friends. It's where they go every day. They get kind of mentored from older students and teachers, and there's pastoral care and development in a lot of independent schools. Like for students, of course, that community is probably quite obvious to many of us, but it's interesting for now schools kind of being that hub of community, like shopping centres where, yeah, parents might go, and a lot of schools now have cafes in them and parents might drop their kids off and then, you know, be there. So it's interesting, like you said, it is this kind of melting pod of different generations coming in, coming out, learning from each other in a formal capacity, but also in a more informal way. So it's interesting to see how that role of schools in our community has changed over time. We know, as you mentioned, teachers were a really important stakeholder group that we surveyed and wanted to investigate their experience. We have written and talked about lots of different elements of this in terms of attracting and retaining the next generation of teachers, a huge challenge at the moment for the future of education. How important, Soph, do you think it is, in light of all of this, for schools to invest in their teachers' experience, and how does this investment impact the overall school community?
It's absolutely huge. And as you mentioned, it's a challenge at the moment to attract and retain teachers to the profession, and particularly that next generation of teachers, as we've got, I guess, an aging profession overall. So in order to continue investing in the future of the nation with education, we need to have a great teaching workforce in that space. And there's a sense of, I guess, calling or vocation for many teachers around teaching, like this inbuilt just desire to invest in the next generation. And that actually helps carry them through, I guess, quite a lot of challenges that maybe they shouldn't have to navigate as teachers. And so I think if you can have a workforce that truly loves what they do, loves the young people that they get to serve and teach and equip and educate, alongside a framework and a structure that actually supports their well-being, that can set them up to thrive really well. Like, the teachers have had to adapt to so much over the last few years, and a lot of our research has found that they've been burnt out, they've been overwhelmed by how much they've had to navigate and achieve in a day. We're starting to see that ever so slightly reduce and settle, but not back to, you know, pre-pandemic levels yet at all. So how do schools help teachers, I guess, through this experience? And our research found that investing in that teaching experience is absolutely essential, because teachers who had high engagement in their school community were 2.5 times more likely than those with low engagement to strongly somewhat agree that they felt supported by the school to provide a quality learning experience, which is huge. And when we see that, when students see teachers supported well, it actually impacts their own learning experience too. So it doesn't, investing in teachers doesn't just have a positive impact on teachers, but it also has a positive impact on the broader school community, on the parents and on the students as well.
Yeah, it has a real flow-on effect. And I liken it, I guess, you know, I'm sure that many of our audience realise we talk about it a fair bit, that we both do a lot of public speaking, and I guess teaching is a public job, like they're at the front of the classroom. And I liken it to when you're, you know, at an event or at as a speaker, it's like you kind of control the energy of the room when you're on stage. And it's like, if you're nervous, if you're emanating a sense of like overwhelm, then the audience is kind of absorbing that whether you want them to or not. And I guess it is, like you mentioned, that flow and effect where it's like, if we look after teachers, if they're well and thriving as much as possible, then hopefully that flows on to the students, and the students get a better learning experience, but also pastoral experience. And yeah, it's, I think for many of us, we know when our cup's kind of overflowing, then we can unload that onto other people. And I guess with teachers, they have such an important role because they are so influential to our young people who are going through different life stages and a very kind of impressionable stage. So yeah, they are such an important group of people to be looking after and caring about. So I know that you are passionate about that topic as well. I'm sure both of us have many teacher friends, and we hear stories from them anecdotally, and then we see it in the data and the research. So yeah, incredibly important. As we think about the different stakeholders, Soph, we mentioned teachers, but as you said, there's parents, a really important stakeholder group, and of course the students. What strategies or initiatives do you think are effective in promoting this increased collaboration between these different kind of groups of people that are important to a school community, or even how do we promote support amongst these different stakeholders to create these thriving school communities?
I think the first point of call is to understand the mindset that people bring. If you think historically schools were some of those gathering places, teachers were really well respected in their communities and looked up to. You know, we've got government schools, but we also have our independent or non-government schools, and that, I guess, fee-for-service mindset can find its way in. And the reality is everyone's life is busy. We've got two parents working more so than we have historically. So, you know, mum volunteering at the canteen or dad volunteering at the canteen, but, you know, we're leaning back into probably what were more historical gender norms and ways of family life back then. It, with one person working and one person generally doing the caregiving, it created more time and space for a parent to be invested in the school community, like the canteens, the reading groups, the volunteering. With two parents working, that's often a lot more challenging. And so that sense of partnership over a child's education has sometimes shifted a little bit more to a fee for service of, okay, you take care of it, I'll do my thing, I'll pay you, you look after it. Question, has that actually worked really well for our education sector, or do we need to bring some of that sense of community back? And we found in our study that those schools that were really thriving had that sense of partnership across parents, students, and teachers to bring about the best outcome for their child. So I think starting with that mindset, and, you know, if you're a teacher or a parent listening, even a student, like, just reflect on how are my actions and my beliefs and my expectations actually contributing to a sense of partnership, or how are they maybe detracting from a sense of partnership? So that mindset is the starting point. And then there's that sense of mutual respect to bring about those outcomes, and leaning into building strength of connection across the community, a sense of community, good, clear communication that people know what's going on, they know what's happening, they're not overwhelmed, and helping paint that bigger picture of actually your contribution matters. I think people often want to help more than we actually think they do. Yes, they're time poor, and sometimes we feel like we are pressuring them by asking them, but people want to help and they want to feel needed. So I think as a school, as teachers, how can you articulate the need for someone to be involved, that actually their presence matters? And that's for students, that's for parents, that's for teachers. And if we can change the narrative around that, around let's actually partner together to bring about the best outcomes for the students in our care, and that actually each of us have an individual contribution that matters to the school community, I think it can start to shape a very interesting conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's fascinating what you were sharing earlier. I mean, I'm so aware of it, but I don't know if I've ever heard it explained so eloquently in terms of just, yeah, that change and the shift that's happened with more parents needing to both be working, and how, yeah, it's kind of evolved from one parent who was probably more on the ground and involved in the community and aware of what was going on and invested. I mean, I'm sure many parents who are working are invested in their child's community, but I guess at the school community, I mean, but it probably takes on a different level when you're a bit further removed, and you're not as involved. Like anything, you kind of just probably don't have as much context or maybe as many relationships with people within the community. And so it's interesting to see how that has kind of evolved. But like you kind of touched on there as well, those timeless elements of everyone wanting to be appreciated and acknowledged and treated with empathy is so important to remember. And I guess that links to even what we kind of tested in this particular study. As we mentioned a couple of times, this is an index. So we had, I guess, elements that we wanted to measure. So if what were some of the key elements that we did test and measure that you found, or that we kind of hypothesized, do contribute to building and sustaining a thriving school community?
Yeah, so this we drew on, I guess, our decade of research in the education sector and doing all these individual school stakeholder surveys and understanding. And we went, what are those key themes that every school was trying to understand how they're going on? And, you know, we've got a collection of questions that we often ask that gets a nuanced response for each school. But then a school's like, well, how are we doing against others? And it's like, oh, well, if you've got a nuanced question, you can't actually compare or benchmark. And it's not so much about benchmarking, but it's about just understanding what are your strengths and what are your growth areas. And so we, I guess, drew that all together into a few key categories. And those are student development, teaching, student well-being, the schooling experience, connection and belonging, and leadership. And really, your student development and your teaching, those are just your ticket to play in the education sector. Like, if you're not doing those well, like, there's not really much chance of building a thriving school community, because that's the basic expectation and foundation of a school. But schools that, you know, are doing well at creating this sense of community and culture of care and investment that actually creates a safe place for people to feel like they belong, so that then they can actually learn well, have more of that focus on student well-being, the holistic schooling experience, the sense of connection and belonging amongst students, and leadership. And we do talk about leadership on this podcast and at McCrindle a lot, because so much of organizational health, of societal health, actually does rest on how well our leaders are engaging with people and how well they are, I guess, able to paint the vision, walk with empathy alongside people, and take them on that journey. And so with our, parents' experience and our teachers and our students, but the schools that were really doing well are those that are able to cater for that individual learning style. They've got that sense of belonging. A key element was, do people feel like they belong in the school community? And yeah, it's an interesting one, because how often do people think about, oh, a thriving school is one where someone actually feels like they belong? But if you belong, so many other doors and avenues kind of open up to you. But yeah, leadership does play that really crucial role, particularly in attracting and retaining teachers. And so much of that is actually around whether they trust the leaders of their school, whether the leaders exemplify their school's values, whether they're well supported. All of those things, the teachers that, I guess, are highly engaged, that are continuing to remain in the teaching profession, they have leadership that are exemplifying all of those character qualities. So to bring it home, to actually answer your question around what are some of those key elements that contribute to building and sustaining that thriving school, it is, those next tier parts around great leadership, great sense of belonging, and understanding the individual before them and catering for that in a way that makes sense for the school.
Yeah, it's I feel like in every study we do, the role of leadership comes out as being like make or break. And in, you know, we see it in the theory of the research, and I'm sure many people can relate to that in practice, where it's like the leader sets the tone, the leadership team, like they're the behaviors that everyone watches, whether consciously or subconsciously. And yeah, it's kind of just reiterating how important that is. And visually in the report, you can see, as you've kind of alluded to, the difference between those who are highly engaged and those who aren't, and just how much more likely they are to agree with some of these statements around, like you said, trust with leadership, that the leaders listen well, all these really important aspects of leadership. So if, just as a sidebar, we talked about these, you know, elements and index, and we might have listeners who work in schools or who are in school leadership who are like, oh, I want to measure this for our own organization. If people are interested in us doing that, could you just elaborate a little bit on, you know, how they can go about getting in touch with us? Like, I guess just explaining this is a service that we offer, because this is helpful and people can go and read about the benchmark. But then I guess it's just always so helpful as well for people to be able to, like you said, contextualize their own unique community, because this is just how teachers and students across Australia are feeling. But each school has its own aspect of community and its own nuance. So if people are interested in doing this, could you elaborate a little bit on the index for them?
Yeah, happy to. And we would like absolutely love to partner with any school on this, because any time a school actually understands what's going on under the cover or under the hood of their organisation as such, you have clarity. And if you've got clarity, you can then actually be intentional and direct your energy into starting to solve the things that are actually going to bring about a great return. But sometimes when you just look at an organisation, you're like, I don't know where to start. And so that's really what some of this Thriving Schools Index is about, is to help schools know what's your next step? Where do you start? What's the thing that's currently low that you can invest some time and attention and energy into lifting the dial? And then what are the things that you're doing exceptionally well in it at the moment, and celebrate that and continue to strengthen that. And we find that if you do it, you know, on an annual basis or, you know, biannually, but probably, no, that's the wrong way, two times a year or what annually, then you can track how you're going and have your efforts actually brought about the return that you wanted to. And the reality with any organization is sometimes you'll have a strength, you'll have a, you know, a growth area, you'll put some energy into the growth area, and then the next time you do it, a different thing will be the area that needs work. And we never arrive at a perfect organization. Like, nothing is ever 100% all the time for every single level. So it's just that metric to be able to track how you're going. So if a school is interested in us being able to conduct the Thriving Schools Index with them, like, get in touch at info@McCrindle.com, give us a call. One of our team will be able to sit down with you, map out how it is, how it works, how our team can support and do the heavy lifting, so that you can just, you know, send the link out and get your report back, and help, then we can unpack what those next steps are. So yeah, it would be our absolute delight to help anybody with this.
Yeah, for sure. And that was a really great explanation as well, just of how this fits into that strategic thinking piece for schools. And same goes as well for anyone who wants to kind of unpack these insights for their school or leadership team or staff. We do a lot of speaking at PD days. So just a sneaky plug there. We would, as you said, love to hear from anyone who's kind of interested. And we talk a lot. Like, I know we've both got the report in front of us, and the slides and the visuals are so amazing. And so they really come to life when you can see the differences in our amazing design team. Kind of put a lot of effort into that. So of course, there's an infographic summary on our website. There's a full report available to purchase, as well as a standalone or as part of our subscription model. But as we kind of zoom back out, so final question, how do you envision, I guess, listeners, whether they're involved in education or not, how can we all play a role in actively contributing to creating more positive and inclusive environments within our own school communities, whether we're kind of alumni or we have kids or we're parents or teachers or grandparents? What kind of big picture advice do you have for all those various stakeholders as to how we can be involved with creating and building thriving school communities?
Culture is most effective when it's owned by the collective. And I 100% believe that each one of us contributes to actively building or detracting from the culture, whether we are aware of it or not. And so my encouragement is to take some time to reflect and go, how is my attitudes, actions or behaviour creating a positive outcome for this culture and building a culture, or how is it detracting from this culture? And so whether that is, you know, you're a busy parent and you're exhausted, which is totally fair. But if you're choosing to not engage in the WhatsApp group, if you're choosing to not turn up to things because you're too tired, which once again, fair. But okay, how is that actually building this culture, or is my behavior currently actually detracting from it? So could you have a goal that, okay, I'm going to try and turn up to just one of the things, or I'm going to try and, you know, share something in the WhatsApp group to actually help build the sense of community. And it's often just those really small actions that have a really large impact, because if everyone is doing something small that's positive, that builds, it really goes a long way. So, you know, to take some Michael Jackson inspo around starting with the man in the mirror, I think that's where we see the greatest social change. So if we want to see flourishing, inclusive school communities, let's reflect on what's our part to play.
Fabulous insights and fabulous advice as always, Soph. Thank you so much for the chat today.
Love it always. Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, including this latest Building Thriving School Communities report, you can always head to McCrindle.com. We've got lots of resources available. You can also subscribe to the podcast, or you can follow us on social media. So once again, as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.